Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Find Your Red Thread, Make Your Big Ideas Irresistible by Tamsen Webster. Narrated by Tamsen Webster. Publisher's note. This audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Find Your Red Thread into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then, under the supplemental content section, please enter the access code RED and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. The figure referenced in the bonus chapter can be found in the bonus material. Words, mademoiselle, are only the outer clothing of ideas. Agatha Christie, The ABC Murders. The fool wanders, the wise man travels. Introduction. This book could have been one sentence. The best way to make your idea irresistible is to build the story people will tell themselves about it. In fact, if you already know how to do that, or if your idea is already irresistible, you can probably stop listening now. I'm grateful you picked this book, but it's not for you. If instead you see that your idea is so powerful that it could change a life, a market, or even the world, but others don't see it yet, then I wrote this book for you. I wrote it for people like you who want their idea to impact the world. I wrote it for people like you who value the possibility of their idea so much that they see it as bigger than they are, who are willing to put the idea first. I wrote it for people like you who, despite their motivation and willingness to do the work, struggle to communicate how irresistible their idea really is. I've already told you what to do. Build the story people will tell themselves about your idea. This technique, which you'll learn how to do in the sections ahead, is called the red thread. Making ideas make sense. In Sweden and other Northern European countries, the expression red thread refers to the core idea of something, the through line that makes it all make sense. You'd say it when you're trying to clarify what something means. You could ask, what's the red thread here? And the answer might be, our red thread is to drive not just action, but long-term change. In other words, you'd use this expression to get to the bottom of questions like the ones you probably get about your idea. What is it? What is it about? And underneath all those, why should I care? Your idea, your product, your brand, your business, your service has a red thread. It is the mental path you took to make sense of your idea. And if you want your idea to inspire action and real, lasting change, it has to make sense to other people as well. They have to see the red thread in it. They have to hear your red thread in your answer to their questions about your business, product, or brand when they land on your website, when they talk with you in a sales meeting or pitch presentation, when they hear from you in an online video or at a conference keynote. Most of all, they have to understand and agree with your idea. They need that red thread as their guide through the maze of other ideas and options and through the maze of their own heads. The red thread will inspire them to act in the way you want them to get the outcome you're looking for. The expression red thread comes from the story of a mythic hero, a slayer of monsters and a master of mazes. You'll soon see that you are a modern-day version of this hero. First, though, you'll have to find what I'll call, capitalized, the red thread of your idea. That's the red thread this book is all about. It is a clear, powerful answer to the most important aspects of your idea, what it is, and why people should care. I'll lay out a process to make sure your idea is as strong as it can be by answering all the questions your audience, clients, customers, investors, are asking about it, both consciously and not. How to use this book. The biggest obstacle to inspiring your audience to act is the gap between what you want to say about your idea and what people need to hear about it. To be inspired to act, the human brain needs to hear a specific structure, and it all comes down to story. In this book, you'll learn how to use five core elements of story structure to express the core elements of your idea itself and any case you need to make for it. Find Your Red Thread has three main parts. In the first, context, I explain the story of the red thread of Swedish idiom and the red thread this book is all about. I also introduce you to the five core elements of story you'll be working with throughout the rest of the book. Establishing a goal, introducing a problem someone didn't know they had, discovering a truth that demands a choice, defining a change in thinking or behavior, describing the action or actions that will make that change concrete. You'll start drafting your own red thread by identifying where you'll use it, with whom, and to what hoped-for end. In the second part, components, we'll get into the details of each of the five red thread statements, specific, templated sentences about these goal, problem, truth, change, and action elements of your story. Each chapter includes a definition of the element, the criteria for that statement, and step-by-step guidance for developing it. You'll also listen to a chapter on the goal revisited, meant to bring your work on your red thread full circle. The chapters in the final part, combinations, show you how to combine red thread statements into the forms I and my clients have found most useful. One paragraph summaries called your red thread storyline, which string together all your work on your red thread statements, and a one sentence summary called a red thread through line, like the one that started this book. Finally, the conclusion reveals two additional interpretations and applications of your red thread, and a third that may be the most important one of all, how finding the red thread of your idea may help you find the red thread of you. Where and how to use your red thread. I've tested the approach you're about to learn with hundreds of ideas and hundreds of clients, including the most skeptical and storyphobic. I'm looking at you, scientists and engineers. I've taught it to thousands more. People have used the red thread method to build communications as varied as these: marketing messages and materials, strategic sales conversations, pitches and internal presentations, public presentations like keynotes, breakout sessions, and multi-part workshops, fundraising asks, books and online content. The results? My clients and others have used the red thread to raise millions of dollars for their research or for their startups or other organizations. Dozens of companies have used it to frame the basis of their internal and market positioning. It's also provided the starting outline for multiple books, including bestsellers, and for hundreds of presentations that range from internal update meetings to keynotes and TED and local TEDx talks, 10 million plus YouTube views and counting. So yes, it helps you get the impact you envision for your idea. Throughout the book, you'll hear a series of examples drawn from this work. Those examples will introduce the following red threads, always in this order: a life science startup called YourSure, which wanted to improve its investor pitch; ethnologist Trisha Wong, who wanted to build a TEDx talk strong enough to be a featured talk on TED.com. It was, and as of this writing, the same has happened with six others of my clients. A nonprofit media company's editorial and fundraising teams, which needed executive team buy-in and financial support for a new project; author, speaker, and coach Linda Ugolo, who wanted to draft a keynote that would serve as the basis of a book, which it did; career coach and career clarity expert Tracy Tim, who wanted to diversify her message to a new audience; speaker, author, and former Second City member Judy Holler, who wanted to revise her current keynote to command higher fees and bigger stages; leadership strategist, author, and speaker Ted Ma, who wanted to differentiate his leadership message from others in the marketplace. One more thing. As you continue, listen to the red thread-based summaries that start each chapter. They are the bones on which I built that particular chapter and this book as a whole. So this book is itself an example of the red thread method at work and of how you can use it to build on your big idea, too. Building the unique, universal story. Great ideas aren't found, they're built, piece by piece, on a unique but universal story. Your story connects how you uniquely see the world with how you uniquely do what you do in it. Your story forms a red thread that you unwittingly follow every day. Without a red thread, your story isn't clear, to you or to anyone else. But with it, each piece of the story, the idea, takes shape, and suddenly, how you see the world changes, often forever. That's the fabled Eureka moment of Archimedes in his bathtub or Sir Isaac Newton with his apple. It's the moment you see a new way to slay your monster. It's the moment you know you can make change happen. But it's also a universal story, one that everyone's brain follows and recognizes. Because of that, it's possible to tell your idea's story in that universal form, to build that red thread in someone else's mind, whether in a casual conversation or over the course of a book. Then they, like you, can have that same moment. They can suddenly see how to slay their monster your way. Your idea becomes theirs. That's the power and the possibility of the red thread. The thing I hear most often from people who use it to drive action from their ideas, it just works. Let's make it work for you. Part 1, context. Good tunes are played on old fiddles. Chapter 1, the story of the red thread. Goal, turn your idea into action and maybe even change the world. Problem, there's a big difference between what you want to say about your idea and what other people need to hear. People need to understand and agree with your idea before they'll act on it. Truth. The human brain has a specific structure for how it processes, accepts, and acts on ideas. Story. Ideas are built on stories. Change. For your idea to truly drive action and lasting change, you need to build a story that people will tell themselves about your idea. Action. To build that story, find the story your brain built about your idea in the first place. That story is your red thread. A tool for every task. Both the red thread we're talking about in this book and the idiomatic one get their name from the solution to a very old puzzle: how to defeat the Minotaur of Greek myth. For one man, Theseus, it was critical to solve that puzzle. As the future king of Athens, he needed to slay the half-man, half-bull monster to save his city. But that wasn't the only problem he had to solve. Even if Theseus could kill the Minotaur, he would have to escape the labyrinth where it lived. The challenge? The labyrinth was so dark and so complicated that even the Minotaur itself couldn't escape. For Theseus, the maze was just as important as the monster. So what did Theseus do? He brought a tool for each task. To kill the monster, he carried a sword. To master the maze, he brought a ball of red thread. With the thread, he traced his path to the monster so that he could retrace his path on the way out. He slayed the monster. He saved his city. What does that have to do with your business, your brand, your offering? In other words, with your idea? As it turns out, pretty much everything. After all, the best ideas are often those that find a new way to solve an old problem, slay the monster, or achieve a desired goal, save the city. They create a change in thinking on scales both large and small. And yet, where those great change-making ideas come from, and how to spread them, too often remains as dark and complicated as the legendary labyrinth. Hearing, or reading, or seeing the red thread of an idea is key to your audience, customers, clients, funders, or anyone else you want to influence, acting on it. Before you can show your audience, though, you must find it for yourself. Just as Theseus did, you need to retrace your steps all the way back to the beginning of your idea. What is an idea, anyway? Once upon a time, you or your company asked a question. How can we? What if we? Why haven't we? Like Theseus, you had a monster to slay. You asked that starting question because you saw a problem to solve, a need to meet, or a goal to achieve. With that question in mind, you sought an answer. You looked at the situation. You probably studied it. You saw other answers to the question. You may even have tried some of those answers. For whatever reason, though, those answers just weren't right. At least, not for you. But then, one day, something changed. You found another way to think about the problem, or you noticed something you hadn't seen before. Once you did, though, it probably seemed so obvious to you that you wondered why you hadn't noticed before, or why no one else had either. Whatever the case, something clicked. The light bulb went on, and you got it. An idea for what to do differently. You knew how to answer that original question in a way that no one else ever had before. Maybe the process was a bit slower. Perhaps the question wasn't a conscious one. It just started as nameless searching. Maybe the answer didn't strike you like lightning. You just slowly started to do things the way you do them now. But I'll still bet there was a moment when you looked around and saw that your way was new and different and better. That's an idea. An idea is an answer, your answer, to a question that doesn't already have an answer or that needs a better one. Your idea is your new way to slay a monster that needs fighting. Other people could use it too, to slay the same monster, if only they knew how. Take, for example, the virtual chat service Slack. It was a new way for companies to communicate with each other, and it solved the problems of email, which itself was once a new way to solve the problems of paper memos and meetings. TED speaker Simon Sinek's Start With Why was a new way for leaders to think about how to inspire action. And once upon a time, a diamond ring was a new way for couples to show their commitment was forever. More on that last one soon. You too have an idea, and your next step is to let people know about it. But that's where the trouble starts. Where ideas fail first and fast. You've probably heard of TED Talks. They're a series of 3 to 18 minute talks about ideas worth spreading that you can watch online. They're one of the many ways people like you get their ideas out into the wider world. I spent 4 years as the executive producer of TEDx Cambridge, the oldest and one of the largest locally organized events building on the TED Talk brand. As part of that role, and as part of my current one as the event's idea strategist, I review aspiring speakers' applications. Right at the beginning of that application, speakers have to answer this challenge. Explain your idea in a single sentence of 140 characters or less. And I have to tell you, most speakers' TEDx talk dreams die right there. Why? Because most of them can't do it. At least, they can't explain their idea in a way that helps us, the organizers, understand it or want to explore it further. They can't help us see why their idea is a new and potentially better way to answer an important question or slay an age-old monster. Out of hundreds of applications, we have only ever seen one that met that standard right out of the gate. Think about that. The applicants are highly accomplished scientists and scholars. Most of the time, they want to talk about the product of their life's work. No one knows more about their ideas than they do. They have all the answers. And yet, they can't explain them. At least, not concisely, or even comprehensibly. Often, when reviewing the applications, my fellow reviewers and I can't figure out what the speaker's idea even is. More critically, we can't figure out why we or our audience should care. I've seen the same phenomenon repeatedly in business, too. For 25 years now, I've worked in brand and message strategy with a huge variety of organizations, nonprofits and for-profits, startup companies, Fortune 500 companies, all the way up to companies in the Fortune 10. I also see it with my individual clients, founders, researchers, thought leaders. Over and over again, great, important ideas never make it out of their creators' heads. The ideas die the moment people have to explain them to an audience. Why? Because it's not enough to have an idea, even if it's great. It's not enough to know how to slay the monster in new and better ways. You need something more than that. You need people to navigate the twists and turns of their own understanding and agreement. So you have to show people how to get through the maze, just like Theseus used his red thread to get through the labyrinth. It's the only way they'll act, and the only way your idea, and all you hope and dream for it, will survive. We'll talk more about that maze soon, but first, let's talk about your idea. The TEDx test. What is your idea? I get it. You may be thinking that none of this applies to you. If you listened to my warning at the beginning of the book and decided to keep listening anyway, you may feel that your idea is already so great and so clear that people immediately see its brilliance and yours. Even the merest hint of your idea is enough to change people's minds and lives forever. Maybe so. But let's find out for sure, shall we? Let's put your idea to the TEDx test. Grab something to write with. Now, imagine you're standing with someone whom you don't just want to act on your idea, but you need them to. Someone like your prospective client, or an investor, or a publisher. And they know nothing about your idea. Imagine you strike up a conversation and they ask you this question. So, what is your idea? Do this. Write down your answer to that question as you'd say it out loud. Don't just think your idea through in your head, because your head will lie to you. Write it down. I'll wait. Okay, got it? Now, looking at what you wrote, answer these questions. Is it one sentence? Is it 140 characters or less? Does it use only words that someone who knows nothing about your idea would easily understand? Does it include something your audience wants? Would your audience agree that they want it, out loud, in front of colleagues or friends? Does it include something they haven't heard before? To know whether or not your idea is clear enough, relevant enough, remarkable enough for someone to be interested enough to learn more, you need to ask these questions. To give your idea a fighting chance, you must get a yes to each one. If you answered no to any of them, then it's very likely the people you're talking to would get lost in the maze that surrounds your idea, which means they wouldn't want to know more. They certainly wouldn't act. They'd likely just nod politely and move on. Take heart, though. By the end of this book, you should be so thoroughly acquainted with this process and your idea that you will be able to craft a crisp, concise, and compelling statement with the power to move your audience to act. I call that your red thread through line. The maze of the mind. Here's the bad news. According to Harvard Business School professor Gerald Zaltman, 95% of our decision-making is unconscious. It happens in the dark, without us even realizing we've done it. The same is likely true for your idea. Even when you're looking for a new idea or innovation, you don't really spend time thinking about how you think about it. Your brain just feeds you messages that tell you, yes, that's it, or nope, try again. Here's why. When you're trying to solve problems, achieve goals, and find new answers to old questions, your brain is navigating a maze you can't see, but you can usually feel. You feel it when your mind keeps spinning on an unsolved problem, or when the answer is just out of reach. The fact that you can't see that maze is why, when the proverbial light bulb suddenly turns on, it seems so surprising. You know the answer is right, but how did you get there? Understanding that journey is critical because that's what people want to know about your idea. How did you get there is what people mean when they ask why you think your idea is the right one, and especially the right one for them. The problem is that we tend to answer that question from the perspective of having already gone through the maze. In fact, because so much of the maze was hidden from view, most of us don't even realize we were in it in the first place. This, my friends, is why so many...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.